All right, so this is the bonding test review. I'm going to break this into a couple of different sections so that I can get through and not have an immensely long video in any one of those sections. So this is going to be 1 through 15. Our first question is, what is the electronic configuration for antimony? All right, so antimony is right here. Oops, sorry, didn't lock that. Right there. So we are going to come down. And we're going to start with the noble gas. Remember, these are our noble gases. That is directly above that. Okay, so we're going to start with krypton. So Kr in brackets. I'm on my fifth row, so 5s2. Remember, the D block is always one less, so 4d10. And then 5p3 would be the electronic configuration for antimony, SB. All right, next we have, what is the difference between core and valence electrons? All right, number two, what is the difference between core and valence electrons? When we are drawing our electrons, and it's easier to see with the Bohr model than it is with the Schrodinger model. Let's say that we're drawing carbon. So we have this inner shell with two electrons on it, and the second shell, which has four electrons on it. All right, these inner electrons are what we call core electrons. They do not interact with the world. These outer ones are our valence electrons. So the outermost shell of electrons are our valence. The inner ones are our core electrons. Valence electrons become so important, this is number three, because they interact. If something is going to hit that atom, if that atom is going to hit something, it hits that first. So that is my defensive line if I'm talking about football. With carbon there, I had four electrons on the defensive line. Boron next to it would only have three. Right, poor little lithium would only have one trying to protect his quarterback. All right, so they are the ones that interact with the world. That's what makes them so important. Number four, what do valence electrons and the noble gases have to do with each other? When the outermost shell is full, and for the most part, that is when it has 8 electrons. Okay, that is a noble gas configuration. And that is what every atom wants to be. Wants to be that, wants to look like a noble gas. So everything that we're trying to do is to make that outer shell full somehow, so it becomes extremely important. Number five, what family are the noble gases? So we have here, these are my noble gases, sorry, these are my noble gases right here. So we look up, it is family 8A. Okay. What charge would barium adopt? Well, barium is right here. It wants to look like a noble gas, so it can either, and remember, with this, we are not worrying about the D block or the F block, so it can either gain 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 electrons and look like him, or it can lose 1, 2 electrons and look like him. That's going to be easier, so it is going to lose 2 electrons, are negatively charged, so it's going to become a 2 plus charge. So the charge that it wants is 2 plus. What are the rows of the periodic table called? They are called periods. Why is the periodic table called the periodic table? It's called the periodic table because it repeats itself. I have lithium here, and he reacts violently with water. I then go across here. None of these guys react nearly as so violently with water, but then I get to sodium, and he reacts violently with water again. So he acts almost exactly like lithium. I go across the periodic table, and then I get to potassium. He reacts violently with water again. I go across, and I get to rubidium. He again reacts violently with water. So it... period means repeating. All right, and the periodic table repeats. Everything in this family reacts the same. Everything in this family reacts the same. Everything in this family reacts the same. It is a repeating table. Why do molecules and compounds form? That goes back to the whole, I have lithium here, and in his valence shell, he's got other shells, but he's got this one in his valence shell. I have chlorine here, and he's got 7. Well, lithium is going to want to get rid of this one so that he can gain that noble gas configuration. Chlorine is going to want to gain that one so that he can look like a noble gas. So molecules and compounds form to look so that everything, molecules, you, and compounds, to look like a noble gas. Okay, everything goes back to that, filling their octet. Okay, number 11. What is the difference between a molecule and a compound? This one we're going to need to look at our periodic table here. And if we draw in our line here, these are our metals, these are our nonmetals. If it is purely nonmetals, and remember that hydrogen also fits in the nonmetals, it's the one that jumps across. If it is only nonmetals, it is a molecule. If it has anything at all to do with a metal, if there is metal in it at all, it is a compound. Number 12, what ratio of arsenic to gallium would be required to bond? All right, so we've got arsenic right here. He is going to be in the 3 minus category. Gallium is right here. He's going to be in the 3 plus category. So it's just going to be a 1-to-1 ratio, or it's going to just be gallium arsenide. All right, what ratio of aluminum to oxygen would be required to bond? Well, let's look. Aluminum is right here. Oxygen is right here. Oxygen is in the 2 minus category. Aluminum is in the 3 plus category. So we're going to go aluminum 3 plus, oxygen 2 minus, and we're just going to shift them down. So aluminum 2, oxygen 3. Make sure that they can't reduce at all. They can't, so that is what the ratio would be, a 2-to-3 ratio. What ratio of hydrogen to carbon would be required to bond? Hydrogen is here, carbon is here, carbon is plus or minus 4, hydrogen is plus 1, so that's going to make this the minus, so we're going to go CH4, so 1-to-4 ratio. And lastly on this one, is H2O ionic, covalent, or metallic? Well, hydrogen is a nonmetal, and you can look this up to assure yourself. Oxygen is also a nonmetal. If I have only nonmetals, then this is a covalent bond. All right, so I will continue on with this on the next video.